I think we're going to go ahead and get started. I have gotten the high sign for us to begin. I'm Fred Bronstein. I'm the Dean of the Peabody Institute. It's a pleasure to welcome everybody again to our Dean Symposium, the second one of the year. We have two more coming up in the spring semester. We have music critic and author for The New Yorker, Alex Ross, who will be with us on February 6th, and then the opera director, Peter Sellers, on April 17th. So we'll look forward to that as well. Here today with us is Blair Tindall, and just a couple of quick notes about Blair, and then we'll get right into it. As usual, we'll be very informal about all of this. I know you've got some clips you want to share from the show, and we'll just chat and then, of course, engage the audience as well. Blair studied oboe at North Carolina School for the Arts. She went on to do a Bachelor of Music and Master of Music degree at Manhattan School of Music. We've discovered we were there basically at the same time. We might have played together, actually. We're not sure, but we might have. She's a veteran of the New York freelance scene. You know that if you've read the book. Played oboe with the New York Philharmonic from time to time, Orpheus Chamber Orchestra, Orchestra of St. Luke's, New York City Ballet. List goes on, of course, in the pit many times in Broadway, Les Mis, Miss Saigon, Man of La Mancha. In her second career, which we'll also talk about in journalism. She had received later, a little bit later in life, her master's in journalism from Stanford. She has written for the New York Times, for the LA Times, Sierra Magazine, of course, the book Mozart in the Jungle, which she completed in 2004, which has since been made into a television show, a comedy series from Amazon Studios. So with that, I think we're gonna launch right in, and I'm gonna ask you, why'd you write the book?
Well, there are a couple of reasons. I went to journalism school at Stanford, and my dear friend Samuel Sanders, who had just died 3 weeks before I got there, he taught here at Peabody. He taught at Juilliard, and he came down once a week and taught here because Peabody gave him health insurance, and at the time, Juilliard didn't. I think they've stepped up their game now. And as some of you might know, he had a very serious heart problem. He was born in 1933 as a blue baby and had a hole in his heart, which I'm going to mispronounce, but I'll try anyway, called tetralogy of Fallot. And he ended up having 5 open heart surgeries. The first one was right here at Johns Hopkins. When he was 9 years old, and then he had 2 heart transplants and 2 other surgeries. And the second heart transplant, he died after that at the age of 62, but his initial life expectancy was only 8 years, so he did pretty well. And he was probably the person, I think it's safe to say, who made piano accompanying a respectable career. So we were asked when I got to school, and remember, I was almost 40 at this time. Of course, I'm only 39 now.
We all are.
We were asked to write a story for our magazine writing class in the Stanford Journalism Program about something that had a significant emotional impact. So I wrote about his going through all of this and how the music community responded, which, you know, we're just like any other group of people. You know, they're great people, they're questionable people. And I had never really written, and I was much older than everyone in the class, and I was chosen to read it aloud. And the class was just silent. I had just given up my job in Les Miserables, which was a $90,000 a year job with great benefits. And I was just thinking, oh no, I made the biggest mistake of my life. And then finally someone said, you have to write a book. But until I was confident that I could make a living without being an oboist, because I knew it was going to significantly change my music career, which it did, I just couldn't do it until then. And then I finally did it. And I read several screenwriting books, because if I was going to write a book, I wanted to make it something that would have a positive impact for the classical music community, and something that could possibly be made into something for the bigger or little screen and become kind of a pop culture thing. So I pored over these books, and I was initially not going to include a memoir in it in the least, but I realized one of the main things that made me interested in writing this book was that the some of the press. There are really wonderful music critics out there, and there's some who could probably do a little more homework. You know, the death of classical music, it was really getting to be kind of an old story that wasn't ever verifiable. So I did a ton of research and just had boxes and boxes of stuff I got at the New York Public Performing Arts Library. And it turned out the one factoid that made me really want to write the book was there was no full-time orchestra in the United States until 1964, when I was 4 years old. And, you know, everybody's acting like that was about the time it went downhill. That's the time it went uphill. So my life paralleled this, and that's why I decided to, you know, include the memoir part, because here's what it looked like from the inside out. Look at all of these people who work so hard, and they're doing kind of heroic deeds and not really getting very much in return in most parts of the business. So that's how the whole thing started, and 2 days after it came out, the Coppola family contacted me and optioned the book. It took them 10 years to get the TV show made, but we won 2 Golden Globes this year and an Emmy. So I'm very happy with it. It's not a documentary, it's entertainment. So, you know, if you really want to watch people making reeds for 10 hours a day, and I like watching paint dry too.
So how did your former colleagues and former colleagues respond to the book?
Okay, so because I've been in the music business for so long, a lot, honestly, most of them were horrified. And Stanford Magazine wanted to write a profile of me. So I gave them the names of my very dear friend, Sherry Seiler, who's associate principal oboist of the New York Philharmonic. And we're still very good friends. And the man who has hired me on Broadway, a conductor named Bob Billig. And I played with him in Les Mis and Aspects of Love and Miss Saigon. And both of them, when they talked to the reporter, were just horrified and didn't know what to say. They were like, oh my God, she made the biggest mistake in the world. And I kept saying, you don't understand what I'm trying to do. I know it looks ridiculous. But now they're big, big fans. And a lot of musicians are big fans. The show is probably hired, by my guesstimate, between 500 and 600 musicians among soundtrack, theme music, music coaches, and on-screen musicians. So it's had a very positive impact on our community, and it's also had a really wonderful impact on people who thought they didn't like classical music, but they watched the show. It's funny, it's well cast. Not that I had anything to do with that. They bought the rights, it's their show. I'm not gonna tell the Coppolas what to do. And the comments on Amazon, I think, speak for themselves. They're overwhelmingly happy comments. A lot of people are taking their clarinets and violas out of the attic and taking them up again.
So let me ask you, I mean, you talked about sort of how you came to write the book, but what was it like cathartic for you to write it, or was it were you mad? I mean,
No, I wasn't mad at all. I had a wonderful career and still do, mm-hmm. in a different way as a musician. Mm-hmm. No, I wasn't mad at all, but I thought it was quite important for people to see that we're real people, mm-hmm. and for young people getting into music to, you know, go into it with a sort of toolbox of things that they should probably learn in school. Things that could help them in their career and what it might be like when they get out, so that when you get out, it's not a big shock. I did the reporting for an article in the New York Times in 2004, which now is a long time ago, about the class at Juilliard that graduated in 1994, 10 years earlier. So my job was to track down everybody, and I think I got everybody except for 4 or 5 people, and see what their trajectory had been. There were a few really successful people who had been soloists, a few people who got wonderful orchestra jobs, and then people who just got out of school and had absolutely no idea what to do now. And the freelance scene at that point was kind of diminished and circling the drain a little bit, so there wasn't that much freelance work as there had been when they entered school. Mm-hmm. I just felt like people need to be prepared and figure out a way to, the music business is always changing. Mm-hmm. I mean, at one point, everybody thought recordings were going to put everybody out of business, and music was going to put everybody out of business. And every 10 years or so, it shifts, and you have to figure out what the next big thing is and how to, you know, prepare yourself for it.
So I want to talk more about that. But you want to play something from the...
Sure, yeah. So the trailer for season 3 just came out, and Placido Domingo is in it, and it was shot in Venice, Italy. So if I can bring this up. Oh dear, I have to sign. Now you're all going to know my password. So also, I was a clue on Jeopardy a couple of weeks ago, which was just, I had absolutely no idea. And somebody from the East Coast, I live on the West Coast, called me, and I was very surprised. And nobody got it right. Okay.
You want to talk about the blood? Heart. It has been bleeding for a while, and I think your voice is the only thing that can save it.
Where's the master?
He's in Italy.
We'll have him back as soon as this
now,
is
resolved. Now, I don't care about your excuses.
I can't talk about the lockout. Scusi, attenzione.
Wait, what?
Tell
me that we'll always be.
The family is dying.
The family is broken. The spell is broken.
You can't tell the orchestra that they're your family and then just leave them.
I love you, goodness.
You left your orchestra. You will leave me.
Cabrona.
I cannot sing what I do not feel.
They're all crazy.
Yo, your ma wannabe?
Yo, your ma.
Yeah.
Yo, mama, yo, your ma.
Hey, you know what? What'd you say?
Sometimes I have trouble with your accent.
He's actually a cellist, that guy.
You really do want to conduct.
Can you help me?
All your dreams are about to happen now.
She cut his hair off.
I've wanted to do that for a long time.
What?
What do we want?
You keep us waiting, losing our minds.
Where are we gonna play?
Are you ready for the changes, Ayala?
I think they're already happening.
Signorina.
Grazie mille. Remember to get there early because it's gonna be a shit show. Oh my god.
So, let me just, while we're on, I'm on the computer anyway, we did win 2 Golden Globes this year and an Emmy. So this is, I'm sorry, I didn't red-eye him, but this is Jason Schwartzman, who's the creator of the show, and he is Francis Ford Coppola's his nephew. And Anton Coppola, the composer and conductor, is his great-uncle, and he's helped a lot with the show. He's even in the show. So there we are with the Golden Globe for Best Comedy, which was pretty exciting. Mm-hmm. And why don't I just right now show the other clip?
Sure.
Of
can we silence our phones, please, folks?
Yeah, what kind of musicians are you people? I had a boyfriend back in the day who wore his ham radio on stage, and every once in a while it would go off with Morse code. Okay, so I think anybody who's watched the show knows that, and this is no secret now, that the Rodrigo character is based on Gustavo Dudamel. So they cast Gustavo in the show. Some of you probably saw this.
He's a natural.
He was great.
He
that
is
was
really
all
good.
Ad-libbed.
Yeah.
And then Gael, the actor, actually went out and conducted the LA Phil in front of 18,000 people, and he was very nervous, but he did okay. He watched a lot of Bronstein videos, so it was all like, you know, no beat patterns, just.
So what's it like to have your, to be the inspiration for a show like this?
I was really happy they picked Lola Kirk to be the oboist character. She's absolutely beautiful and a wonderful actress.
Uh-huh.
I was terrified it was gonna go the other direction. Because we are a little nerdy.
Right.
They really did a good job. They've been so incredibly nice to me. I even have a cameo in the show. I'm on the soundtrack. Occasionally they call me with a question or something, mm-hmm. and usually the author is not that welcome around. There's been a lot of snarking online. This thing isn't absolutely correct, but you know what? It's a video medium is very different, and you have to move it along kind of fast. So they're aware of it because there's another musician in the Coppola family, and the Coppolas are all involved. Roman, who's Jason Schwartzman's cousin, is also a creator of the show, and their grandfather, Carmine Coppola, was principal flute of the NBC Symphony. He was in the Met for a while. Mm-hmm. So they do know what they're doing.
Yeah. So, we'll talk more about this, but be interested to hear from you now that you're out of this part of the business you were in before, how you see things 12 years after you wrote the book in terms of the music world, and we'll talk a little bit about what folks need to do to be prepared for that world.
Well, one thing that I pointed out in the book that has the pace of it has changed is the cycle of orchestra strikes and lockouts. It used to be, and I'm just kind of saying this off the top of my head, it used to be every 7 years or so that there was a spate of these things. And last year, of course, there was a lot of trouble in the orchestra world, and they based a lot of the show on that. In fact, this season the orchestra is still locked out, mm-hmm. which is why they went to Italy. Mm. Now it's, just two or three years later, all of these orchestras have been locked out and on strike, and something's got to change with budgets. I mean, when the book started as something that was meant to be about the rise of culture in late 20th century America, that really started in 1956 with the Ford Foundation matching grants, but that was kind of an idealistic thing, and when those stopped, then that was twice as much money, generally, mm-hmm. as the real grants, right. And then now people are going to have to face the music, so to speak, and figure out how to readjust their orchestra budgets.
Yeah.
But the thing that I found was, as I was approaching 40, I thought if I heard that helicopter land in Miss Saigon one more time, I was going to kill somebody. It's a great job. Broadway is a really wonderful job, and I feel very fortunate that I had it because I have a pension and I had wonderful benefits and great friends, and mm-hmm. it was a good experience, but it is repetitive. So I went and got some aptitude testing, and here is something that I think a lot of musicians aren't aware of, because we live in our own world, and we have since we were so young. We all have to start very young, and I wasn't aware of what I was good at or bad at, or even what I liked and didn't like, because I had been a pianist since I was 4 and an oboe player since I was 11. So this was, as the Geico ads say, it's what you do. So I took the usual stuff that people take in college, like Myers-Briggs, and I took something called the Strong Campbell Interest Survey, and it asks you questions about what you think about yourself. And it came back with exactly one job opportunity for me, as a poultry inseminator.
There really is such a thing?
Yes.
Wow.
Sounds dangerous, actually. But I think I'm really not shilling for them, but it's given by something called a nonprofit organization called the Johnson O'Connor Research Foundation. And they make you perform tasks that evaluate your innate abilities, and these are the things that don't change through life. It's just what you're naturally good at. And there were a lot of surprises, because I had just told myself, oh, I'm really good at these two things, and I got horrible scores in those, and I'm terrible at these things, and I got great scores in those. Mm. And one of them was a creativity measure, and apparently I got one of the 5 highest scores I'd gotten in 80 years for that, and I had just gone through life thinking I was terribly uncreative. And one thing that they pointed out to me, and everybody's different, I'm not saying this is going to apply to anybody else in this room, But they said, because of that, and because my I was at the extreme end of the extroversion scale when I thought it was the other way around, I was a terrible fit to be a musician performing music of other people, and that I would probably be happier if I were going into composing or composition. So I didn't do either of those things, but this is sort of a nice compromise.
So, I mean, one of the things that comes through in the book, and is, I think is interesting, particularly later in the book, is when you start to make that transformation or explore that. And it's interesting that resonated with me. I've done something like that over the course of my career a couple of times. And I'm wondering how difficult was that for you, and how liberating was it for you? And did you want to stay connected with music? Was there a time when you didn't want to stay connected with music at all and just do something completely different?
Well, those are all good questions. I do kind of hate the oboe. I got assigned to the oboe because I was at the end of the alphabet in sixth grade, and that's what was left. Now, I actually, when I have a great read, I love playing. It's great. I love being in the middle of an orchestra. Like, my first concert subbing with the New York Philharmonic was Mahler Sixth, and I feel sorry for the audience because I'll never be able to experience that visceral feeling of being in the middle of a Mahler symphony like that. It's incredible. But I am terrible at making reeds, and I went to everybody who's an expert and just did everything I possibly could, and I'm still pretty bad at it. So now
that's tough if you're an oboe player.
It's really a big thing.
Yeah.
However, when I went to school, it was a little scary because I'm driving across the country by myself, gave up this great job, and I get to Stanford, and the second day I was there, I'm playing second oboe in the San Francisco Symphony. I know a third of the orchestra from New York. My friend is playing principal, and it was just great. It was like, it was something so familiar because all orchestras kind of have the same routine and schedule, and it was in this world where I was such a fish out of water. It was really nice, and I kept playing the whole time. When I moved to LA, I was really not very welcome in the music world, so I end up doing chamber music festivals that old friends invite me to do outside of town, and the show, of course, does hire me. But that was a shock. I mean, it wasn't a shock. I knew that was going to happen, but it was something very different, and it made me sad.
There's a moment when you talk about the fact that you don't have to, in a way you can love it more because you don't have to do it anymore.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's very true. And in fact, I listen mostly to classical music on the car radio, and being in LA, I'm in a car a lot. And I just, you know, I really listen more closely than I used to.
Mm-hmm.
And when I did this wonderful festival in Montana, it was such a delight. Really great musicians, some old friends, some new friends. And it was, I'd never really enjoyed playing that much. And I'm looking forward to playing the Mozart Concerto, which I've never performed.
Mm-hmm. Which you're doing, you're going to be doing.
In February, yeah.
That's great.
In Oregon.
So what do you think? I mean, one of the things that we're talking a lot about at Peabody today is and implementing changes, real changes around curriculum and ensemble experiences, and how to better prepare people for the kinds of careers that they're going to face and the kind of opportunities and the fact that those opportunities are changing. What are thoughts that you have on that, and what advice, not so much the specifics, but in terms of maybe attitude, and how you think about all of this, would you give to young musicians today?
Well, the last part of my educational trajectory was in Silicon Valley, where networking is obviously a very big deal. And I think in this climate where you don't just audition for a job much of the time and just get a job and plug in, even if you do, you need to have a network and you need to have other skills, especially communication skills. Most of you are quite a bit younger than I am, so you're probably already great at that, but just writing, communicating, When the book came out, I got a lot of requests to speak to groups, and I speak to a lot of screenwriting groups and things. So I took some training in that, which helped immensely, because you know, there are a lot of things you just need a little help with. So I think it's essential to do all of that kind of thing and realize that you can't be, you know, a monolith anymore. And even some people who are in the Philharmonic who are a bit older than I am, even, do things. There's a violist who does narration for children's concerts. And, you know, it really puts its extra value for her and the Philharmonic. So I think all of that's important. One other thing that I have to stress is getting along with people. So if you're an undergraduate, you're going to be knowing these people for the rest of your life. It's a very small world. And, you know, if you have a misstep with somebody when you're 18, it can follow you till you're 60 and be kind of unpleasant. And I have a good example here. Somebody I have never actually met in person wrote a book kind of similar to mine. And it's just a different type of book. It's isolated vignettes from his life as a freelance musician, and he was snarking on me a little bit on the internet, which I'm very used to now. And so I thought, well, let's just make friends. So I bought the book and I read it, and it's really quite good. So I wrote to him and I said, oh, I really loved your book. And he was really surprised, and he said, really, what did you like? So we talked a little while, and you know, my attitude is a rising tide lifts all boats, and it's just a lot better. We're in enough trouble already. It's a lot better to stick together and help one another.
Do you think, where do you think classical music is going, and where do you think its place will be? And do you think it's relevant?
Judging from the response in the Amazon comments, people think they don't like it. And then they see this funny soap opera about us, and they listen to the music without realizing they're listening to the music, and then they go out and buy the music. So I think it is quite relevant, but I think we have a long way to go in terms of how to present it so it's not so threatening or it doesn't seem so boring. And I'm not sure where to start with that. There are a lot of orchestras and new chamber music groups and such have done a wonderful job with that. And Deborah Borda at the LA Phil programs a lot of contemporary music that sells out the hall, which is kind of surprising. So people are interested. I think it's just a question of, not just, but we need to really refine the way that we present it.
No, I think that's. I think it's venue. I mean, we've certainly talked a lot about that. It's venue. It's format. It's programming. I mean, it's. I think it's all of those things. How people access music today and what kinds of experiences that they want.
And I think people do still want the Warhorse experience, and so many of the. I think that the piece that people liked most in the show was Sibelius Violin Concerto, which kind of surprised me, but. A lot of comments about that online. And actually, there was a whole episode about 1812, and people just loved it. So, And a friend of mine wrote that, actually. She's kind of me. She got a journalism degree at, she's a violinist who got a journalism degree at Columbia.
So maybe it's a good time to open it up and take some questions if we have some, and I've got some more questions as well, but.
Hi. I'm curious, so I presume you were writing before you went to Stanford, and I'm just wondering if your education in North Carolina or in Manhattan School helped in any way with your writing skills, developing any of those?
No. No, I wasn't writing. However, my father was a professor of Southern history who wrote 10 books. He wrote the leading American history textbook, so I wasn't new to publishing, it seemed like a normal thing. I had a great English teacher, still in touch with him, from the School of the Arts, and my freshman humanities teacher, James Sloan Allen, who taught for a while at Juilliard too, was absolutely fantastic. But aside from that, I never wrote a thing until I applied to journalism school. And then I thought I'd better write something, so I wrote a travel essay. And so I had a travel essay in the New York Times and an art story in the Wall Street Journal the first week. Then there was a big dip in the road. But no, I mean, that's something that I think may have gotten better at conservatories, and it's certainly gotten a lot better at the North Carolina School of the Arts. They're preparing kids a lot better. But this was way back in the 70s, and arts education was fairly new.
Yeah. Other questions? Yes.
So when you were talking about skills that we should start really working on and being able to communicate well and being able to write well, what kind of things do you suggest getting started on to improve that as far as in the form of writing?
I can't stress to you how useful just a basic journalism class is for two reasons. It teaches you how to organize your ideas in a succinct way, although I may not be demonstrating that today. And the other thing is it tells you how to communicate with music journalists in a way that they will, this is sounding really harsh, but in a way that both sides understand so that, you know, the point gets across. Because I think sometimes they're just misunderstand. There's some really well, highly trained music journalists who know an awful lot about music, and every once in a while on a smaller newspaper you'll get, you know, the basketball writer gets thrown into the classical music beat or something. Mm. and could use your help. I think the other thing is, frankly, there are like public speaking courses, and you're going to have to get up on stage and talk to people. And I think it's useful to figure out how to organize your ideas by doing that. And then, of course, all the social media stuff, but you're all way better than I am.
So technology. What about community engagement?
Definitely. I don't know that much about that, but that is a very good point.
Mm-hmm.
I did a lot when I was in school and just right after children's concerts with the woodwind quintet. And we really got out there and mingled with the kids with varying results.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think it's certainly something that we're working at here in terms of building it into the curriculum, because it's, even if you're in a major orchestra today, you're going to be doing that activity.
Definitely.
Yeah.
But I've noticed a lot of times that, you know, there's just such a barrier between the audience and the stage, and when somebody actually meets somebody that they recognize, you know, Stanley Drucker or somebody who's a solo chair in the New York Philharmonic, they're kind of shocked because they are so used to seeing them from afar and not realizing they're a warm human being.
Mm-hmm.
So I am not sure what to do about that, but I think it's quite important.
No, there's no question that in, you know, in my experience with orchestras and my time with orchestras, one of the things that was most of interest to audience members was connection with the musicians. Knowing something about the musicians, you know, and what their lives were like.
Yeah.
And what it's like to play in an orchestra, but what their lives are like, actually.
Well, it's, you know, people are constantly posting on Facebook about they'd run into somebody at Kroger's or something in the grocery line, and they'd say, oh, you look just like, you know, that viola player in the Richmond Symphony or something. And then, well, I am that viola player.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Really? And you're buying groceries?
Right. No, I mean, I think there's really, I think audiences tend to sort of see this as this almost kind of mystical, you know,
definitely
mysterious, mystical thing. And because it is magical in a lot of ways, you know, to most people. And I think that, you know, when they can actually sort of get closer to that and get on the inside of that, I think it has a lot of meaning.
Well, there's a wonderful story right now. Eileen Moon, who's, I believe, assistant or associate principal cello of the New York Philharmonic, has recovered from cancer, and she took up running and she's also a dog aficionado. So she has founded a, she's on the cover of Runner's Magazine this week, I mean this month. And they chose her because her story is so compelling. She has a runner's group that's all cellists.
Oh.
And she has a pit bull rescue. So that's something where she's really out there in the community and people are intrigued. There was a story on something, Nightline or something about her recently. And, you know, people are really charmed that here's this person who's just so incredibly normal.
Right.
And she plays the cello in this fancy orchestra.
Yeah. So what's your most outrageous freelance story? I mean, that you can present here.
I don't know if anything's that outrageous, because we... You know, we do stick to, everybody's always surprised when I show up on time. You know, like, duh.
That's what you do, yeah.
I think back when I was not a member of Orpheus, but I love Orpheus, they're fantastic. And I was a sub, and we had such a hard time getting a rehearsal schedule together once that we had a 7 a.m. rehearsal and a midnight rehearsal. But aside from that, I can't think of, well, I guess the whole, so the reason that the book is called Mozart in the Jungle, this was an outrageous story, and, you know, I was a freelancer because I was a substitute, not a regular in the Philharmonic, and we were in South America, and 15 of us were taken off the tour just for one night to play a concert for our benefactor, which was Citibank, in the middle of the desert at the Iguazu Falls, where the mission movie opens at this beautiful place. So we all get there, we fly in, Zubin is with us, and like the bass trunk and the cello trunk are not with us, apparently. They didn't appear, and most of our clothes were there, most of our music was there, the bass and cello were there.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't come, they'd taken it off the plane. And there were 600 people waiting to hear us play.
Mm-hmm.
So it was 1987, so it was the end of major corporate funding for the arts. So it was a double entendre. We were playing a Mozart octet in the jungle, and Mozart was in the jungle now because the funding had really dried up quite a bit. That was the manager of the Philharmonic, Nick Webster. I've never seen anybody so pale in my life. He was just waiting in the no more bags on the carousel.
Yes, that's a bad feeling. Yes, it's a really bad feeling. Good. So, in terms of, you know, a lot of students, a lot of folks will come out of music school and will have what we call portfolio careers. And I think if somebody reads your book, they might say, well, that's not a very good way to have a career. Is that right or not right?
Sometimes you don't have that much of a choice. And I felt very fortunate because I was able to play with these fantastic groups and wonderful musicians from the time I was in school. And then Broadway is really a great job.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I have a wonderful retirement fund because of Broadway.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very flexible. Mm-hmm. People are great. It's a little repetitive, but that's so are a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
I had a pretty standard and sort of top-of-the-line freelance career, which a lot of my friends are still doing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and a lot of people really like doing. I mean, I had a lot of friends, have friends that they liked it. I mean, they actually preferred it to playing a single kind of gig, and it was because of the flexibility. And I mean, and most of these people were well placed enough that they could, you know, they were doing things they wanted to do. But
well, I certainly had some wonderful concerts that I'll never forget. I got to play with Bernstein.
Mm-hmm.
And the company I kept was really pretty fabulous.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm still friends with most everybody.
Mm-hmm. Yes, back here.
So you mentioned that you have to do research for this at the New York Public Library. And you obviously did a lot of reading. Is there a single book that had the most profound impact on you?
Yes. She died recently, but Alice Goldfarb Marquis, I'm blanking on the name of the book, but I think it was Art Matters, possibly. And she had the most comprehensive account of arts funding and arts development in America. She'd really done her homework. And Alex Ross's book is absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, it's a great book.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is.
By the way, you mentioned Peter Sellers is coming.
Yeah, yeah.
I had forgotten this, but apparently in the early 80s, he set The Marriage of Figaro in Trump Tower.
Oh. Well, I'll ask him about that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes.
Just on the topic of the changing orchestra and musician, because that's something we're big on at Peabody. One of the things that people talk about a lot is how formal any given performing ensemble is, and some people, you know, say that the fact that we're all up there in tuxes under this facade is good, and some people want to completely break that away. And so we're just interested, since you've played with so many different kinds of things, from New York Philharmonic to the Jungle, do you think that in terms of a performance, people, the audience, would prefer or is heading in the direction of less formality, or that there's something that people like about the showing up to a concert hall, lights dim, tuxedo experience?
That's a great question, and I think about that all the time, because there is, I mean, these are nonprofit organizations that, in some ways, this is kind of a blanket statement, in some ways were formed in the early part of the 20th century as a social club for wealthy people who are the people who support them. I mean, the League of American Orchestras came out with a paper that I haven't completely gotten through yet a few weeks ago that does talk about the fact that orchestras are becoming more and more reliant than they even were before on contributions. So these are the people who really like that, I think. And I'm not, you know, I think that is a very pleasant thing. On the other hand, there are people who come and really are very petrified of the experience, and they don't know where to clap. And I've often been with people who have not been to that many concerts, and I just can't bring myself to clap between movements, but I think it's totally fine. I think it's great. Mm-hmm. We can use all the applause we can get. But then they're looking at me and going, oh, what should I do?
And
So that's problematic. And not very long ago, in the late years of the 19th century, people clapped between movements. The New York Philharmonic played in beer gardens. Yeah. I mean, it was a very raucous kind of fun thing.
Yeah. I think it's a mistake to think that the audience is monolithic. That in fact, you know, you have to think about different kinds of audiences and therefore different kinds of experiences for different audiences. I think it's one of the mistakes, actually, that performing arts, you know, organizations, whether ensembles or ARPA companies, whatever they are, have made over time, that it's, the audience isn't monolithic, and that there are different, you have to serve different audiences in different ways, in different places, and with different kinds of programming.
Well, I think the TV show Mozart in the Jungle has made some major inroads in that. Mm-hmm. Like Rodrigo takes his orchestra out to an abandoned lot, and they just play. I mean, of course, this would never actually happen, but you have to suspend, you know, just enjoy it. So they play the 1812 overture, and you know, and it's actually was shot on the Lower East Side, but it looks like it's in Spanish Harlem. And people are coming to their tenement windows and really enjoying it, and they're in awe over it, and kids are running up and looking through the fence.
Yeah, sure.
Then everybody gets arrested.
So does Gustavo like the show?
He loves it. He was afraid to watch it at first because he thought we were making fun. Well, not me. I'm going to not take any credit for this, but that they were making fun of him. And then Deborah Borda made him watch it, mm-hmm. I think. Mm-hmm. And he loved it, and there's a lovely video online of him having a conversation with Gael, who plays his character, mm-hmm. and they have a bromance now.
Yeah,
that's for sure.
Yes, over here and then back there.
So, with the perceived problems in classical music, how much do you think of that burden of changing the community falls on us as performers going into that scene? I mean, is there a greater call for the artist to also be the arts advocate at the same time, to be petitioning groups, or will change likely be more widespread and more permanent if it's done at a managerial executive level?
Great question.
Well, I think those two groups that you mentioned can't do it in the same way. But something like Eighth Blackbird. Now, there's a group that really presents itself in a way that interests people, and so they're sort of serving a little bit of both. So in that way, the arts entrepreneurship, which I know is, I mean, I didn't even bring it up because it's kind of a, it's become such a mainstream topic now, is really the responsibility of performers like us. But even though there are some extraordinary arts administrators out here, there are some who are not getting the job done, and you know, they're just sort of tone deaf about it. So I think, you know, I think that there has to be some change on that level, and I don't know. I mean, there are some, like the League of American Orchestras has an internship program that a lot of people have come up.
Not anymore, they don't.
Oh, they don't?
No.
Okay. Well, never mind.
They just spend it.
But there are some educational opportunities for arts administration, and I hope more people who are performers take advantage of them.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I will, I say this all the time, that I think that on the issue of arts administration, I think the field is, these are very tough jobs. And you've got some critical things to say about, and rightfully so. They are very tough jobs, and I think that the talent, you know, is the talent pool is not nearly deep enough. So if you develop that talent and it's a direction you want to go in, there's an important place, I think, for people that develop those skills and are courageous and can do that kind of work. I think on this question though of, you know, that it's a great question that you asked, and I think this notion of there has to be personal responsibility of the artists in this too, and there has to be, I mean, you know, and people that have been in orchestras and run orchestras like myself will say, you know, our responsibility is to manage the organization well and to create the kind of programming and to do the work to bring in audiences and to raise money. But we also need to, very frankly, by the time musicians get to the professional performing arts organizations out of schools historically, they're it's too late. They're not, you know, they're already formed in terms of how they think about what they do. And I think that's why I think the direction we're going in here in terms of changing that training and building this component that everybody has to do and that's part of what you get here is really essential. People have to think differently about, I mean, we are all in the audience development business. I think every single one of us.
I keep forgetting how old I actually am. That happened fast. But when I was an undergraduate at Manhattan School, they remember when they started that Office of Career Development?
Yep.
And that was just such a new idea and sort of, you know, rocked everybody's world. And it's definitely obviously come a long way since then, but it's still kind of a new idea.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I think the challenge for most schools, most of the major music schools, is that, you know, we've talked a lot about this here, is that everybody, you know, has pieces of these programs, but it's not infused in everything that people do, and it really needs to be. You know, there should be no escape from it, you know, if you're going to go through a music program, I think.
Well, I did one of the first places that I spoke to an audience was Virginia Commonwealth University, and the snarking on the book was very big back then. I was definitely the enemy, even though nobody'd actually read it. But anyway, a big part of my thoughts for them were, and this is so outdated now, you have to have a website. And of course, that's, you know, we've come so much farther than that now. But, you know, that was big news at the time to people. And people were pretty interested, especially people, upperclassmen, because they were getting out. And what do I do now? Mm-hmm. How do I further my career? Mm-hmm. So I don't know what the next step with social media is, but I think there's also, it's possible to be too active on too many platforms there, so it's probably better to limit yourself to a couple.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, what's fascinating about all of this is that there's no barrier now really between getting what you do out there. I mean, there's so many ways to get out your product as a musician.
It's true.
Yeah.
Yeah, and there's probably something, when I wrote the book, I was struck when I was going through all of these old news stories about how there was always something every 10 years or so completely new. And that, I don't know if many people know this, there was actually a ban on recording in the United States in the mm-hmm. mid-40s wartime. You couldn't record anything. So there's always
because of the materials. Was it because of the materials you couldn't? They needed the
right. But there's always something new, and you have to look ahead. There's always somebody like this is a minor thing, but who'd have thought we were gonna read music on iPads and have an AirTurn pedal? That's pretty awesome.
Yep, that's right. Back here.
Sure. As we're thinking about, having musicians take more responsibility for their entrepreneurship and audience development, do you think our stories need to change? And thinking as a journalist, oftentimes we're asked to put together a bio, for instance, put together the story of what we've done, but it doesn't seem like that connects to how do we reach an audience, and is there something that we need to do to change this?
I hadn't thought about that, but that's a really great point, is when I think about my bio, it's a little, you played in this, and you played in that, and that's kind of it. But the story of what appealed to you about becoming a musician or music or your instrument, and maybe having in the bio an early life story or some remarkable story of a performance would be a lot more attractive than just reading this list of groups that you've played in. So I think that's, the storytelling aspect is probably more important now. I think that's a great point.
Do you think, just coming back to sort of the book and the aftermath of the book, do you think that people were partially angry, or part of the response was because they couldn't escape themselves?
Well, I got, as I was leaving my last Broadway show before I went to Stanford.
Because what comes through really powerfully in the book, and it really is, I mean, it's very strong, is just how trapped you feel.
Yeah, I mean, some people, there's some polymaths in classical music, as we all know, who are like, basically nuclear engineers in a cellist body or something. But I was not one of those people, and I didn't have a very strong high school or college academic education. So I did end up going back to school and just taking normal courses that college kids have when I was in my 30s. But yes, I felt completely trapped. And as I was getting older, I thought, what's happening to the music business? Is it going to go down the tubes? Then what will I do? And so I got into the only business that's even makes me less employable than classical music, journalism.
That is interesting.
But it worked out eventually.
Yeah. Of course. Sarah.
Thinking about all the tests that you took when you were trying to figure out what's next, where do I go, have you ever wondered whether that's a kind of experience that music students should have while they're music students as well?
Absolutely. The Johnson O'Connor Research Foundation test I took, and they're not paying me, was absolute. I had so much fun that day, and it was very interesting to find out how wrong I was about strengths. And of course, I took it with a grain of salt, but then over time, they were right. It actually was true. And we tell ourselves things as we go through life. When they test for four different kinds of memory, like musical, design, verbal, and something else. And I'd gone through life just saying, oh, I have such a bad memory. And then I realized I can remember almost any telephone number anybody's ever told me once. So how, but we tend to just say these things for some reason. So I think it is great for music students to explore that kind of thing, because we do even if you're a square peg in a round hole, you just keep trying to get it in there. Mm-hmm. And you may still, of course, want to be a musician, but just add something onto it or do it in a slightly different way. Like, I'm going to see our classmate, Marin Alsop, after this. And, you know, when they suggested conducting, I thought, oh, come on. And now I wish I'd done it, but also my character in the show is becoming a conductor this year. It's kind of making me mad.
Yeah, those conductors, you know, those pesky conductors, I tell you.
Other questions? Back here.
Earlier, this is jumping back to earlier in the conversation. I was surprised we were talking about how to develop writing and public speaking skills, and Dean Bronstein asked you about what do you think about community engagement, and you had to think for a minute, thinking, and I guess I had thought, I mean, this is your book, or in the show, that is community engagement, that this has touched a really big population in a really compelling way, and I guess I was wondering what you see as, I see the way that you were able to touch so many people is this like really rigorous interdisciplinary sort of perspective that you were able to add. And I guess I'm not sure exactly what my question is, but but I'm interested in that relationship, the not thinking very so narrowly about engaging the community by, you know, musicians trying to tell a specific story from our own perspective, but how that can be enriched. In either conversations or in different kinds of training, like that another discipline can bring a richer dimension to how the story is presented.
Well, I have to say, I think as musicians, and I assume probably everybody in the room is one, we forget how striking what we do is to somebody up close. It's the ultimate party trick. People are, when they actually are up close to you and hear you play, you know, the look of awe is kind of like, wow. I mean, it really is an amazing thing that musicians do. And I did a lot of, I got a lot of benefits from the Actors Fund, which services all the performing arts unions. A lot of education, I learned to use a computer through them. And so I did a benefit. Never thought I would be saying something like this in Palm Springs for them, where I spoke and I played a little bit for them. And, you know, there were stars there like Lucy Arnaz and Pamela Gray. And, you know, they all were, and also the catering help. Like everybody, I just played a short piece and everybody stopped and really listened. And, you know, it is, especially when it's close up and you can really see what the musician is doing and hear it so intimately. We got a lot of donations, so that was good. But it is a great thing to do that kind of work too in the community. I'm going to do a reading in my town, the town where I live in California, and play a little bit, and you know, a bunch of people from the community will come, and it's for a library fundraiser. So I think that kind of thing is essential, but you do have to come up with new ways to do it.
Thank you.
I slept with the conductor. No, I didn't. No. I wasn't his type. So. No.
Well, you do have that great line in the book where you.
I know. I wish I'd never written
yeah.
that. Oh my God! I thought it was.
You were exaggerating. Tongue in cheek. You were exaggerating.
So here's how I got it. I was 27, and a friend of mine, her mother was the oboist in Les Mis. So this the best gigs of my life. I got through other women because we do try to help each other sometimes. And so her daughter convinced her to have me come as a sub, and I was just so totally paranoid that I just was so overprepared. And soon after that, I got invited to go out. The contractor for that show invited me to go on the road with something called The Music of Andrew Lloyd Webber in concert, which was absolutely hysterical because he and Sarah Brightman were actually on the tour. Mm. And I'll leave it at that. But anyway, so after that, I did get hired for one of Andrew's shows called Aspects of Love, and just directly went into Miss Saigon and then switched over to Les Mis from there. So that's, I mean, you get Broadway gigs from subbing, basically, and doing a really good job and being pretty available.
So in the book, some names are real, some aren't. How did that, is that right? I mean, how did that work? And
oh, very straightforward. I got a lot of thank you notes for leaving some people out. But generally, everybody, with the exception of two people, was I meant to represent in a very positive mm-hmm. light. Mm-hmm. And I'm about to come out in a book, I'm pretty sure, in a not positive light. And it's like, you do the crime, you do the time. So anyway, so it was vetted by an attorney, because it's the publisher is a fairly, it's one of the last independent publishers of any size. So it was vetted by an attorney, and there's certain things where there might be a legal issue. So on the copyright page, the groups and people who are identified by other names are listed there. Mm-hmm. And the reason that is if, say, somebody named Jane turns up in the book and is like a tall redhead, and somebody named Jane turns up and is a tall redhead, then mm-hmm. you might have a libel issue. Mm-hmm. So that's how that works.
Yeah.
But there were very few names. There wasn't much reason to change names. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I mean, I really like these people.
Yeah, no, and that comes through. I mean, it's very sympathetic, and it's you tell their story as well as telling your own story.
Yeah, yeah. And I was a little nervous about Sam, because I knew his story so well. And his Sam Sanders and his brother, Martin, came to my reading at Lincoln Center, and I was like, oh my God, is he gonna shoot me? What's going on here? And then he comes up to the stage with this giant stack of books he wanted me to sign. I was thrilled. Huh. He really liked it.
Yeah, that's great.
You touched a little bit on this when you said, you know, you always show up on time, but I'm curious, from your life as a musician and as a freelancer, what kinds of things did that work teach you that have helped you be successful in other areas?
Well, I think the main thing is when you have to show up on stage and play something, it's got to be, you've got to be prepared, you've got to be there in plenty of time. So for an interview or something as a journalist, the same thing applies. And I mean, I'm surprised now that I'm interviewed by people, the variance in how prepared people are. Some people are just fantastic, and some people, you know, get your name wrong, which is amazing. I mean, really wrong. I was Blair Tindall once.
So Blair, on the work you do, you call it flair for genius.
Yeah.
So how do you teach that? And I mean, it's sort of this transformation work that you're.
Yeah, well, it's the thing about the aptitudes that I was talking about earlier, which I think is so important for people to realize. There's a man who does this also named Marcus Buckingham, and it's, so instead of focusing on things you're not good at, it's finding the things that you're good at and focusing on that and overriding the things you're not good at with that, and nobody's good at everything. Mm-hmm. So it's speaking engagements, it grew out of the training I did as a speaker when I, you know, at the time the book came out, I was less than popular in the music world, so I really wasn't getting much work. So they suggested that I go in this direction because I'd been so successful with focusing on that and making a new life for myself. And especially now, when everybody is so displaced in their careers and things are changing so rapidly, I think that's a very important thing. And you know, I don't do shows every night anymore. So there before the show TV show took off, I was really struggling there for a while. I was driving an airport limo in the middle of the night, and you just do what you got to do. So, and I have to say, there are positives to everything. I met some of the most interesting people. Mm-hmm. I picked up Dean Martin's kids on Thanksgiving Eve, and they were hysterical. It was one of the best nights of my life, actually. So that's what I'm focusing on with that, because I went through it mm-hmm. and came out on the other end.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you always have to be evolving and mm-hmm. changing, no matter how old you are. Mm-hmm.
But would you have ever have imagined, you know, 20 years ago, that you'd be doing what you're doing?
Absolutely not.
Yeah.
No, I was terrified, and I just didn't know what was going to happen.
Yeah.
I mean, am I going to, as the Broadway shows were shrinking and shrinking, the orchestras, mm-hmm. And yeah. of course, straight oboe books are not that popular. Mm-hmm. I was really wondering what I was going to do. Mm-hmm. You know, and I almost pushed the big red button and went to law school. I took the LSAT and everything, and I really didn't want to, mm-hmm. so I didn't.
Sometimes people are devaluing our work because they don't really understand what we are doing. Like, you know, like, they focus on, like, you're playing music, so you must have fun, and, like, you just have fun. But, like, they devalue how much work you need to do in the practice work. How do you deal with that?
Fortunately, I sort of was in the right place at the right time, so I really didn't, but I see it all the time. And, you know, on Facebook, there's no shortage of people finding these ridiculous ads on Craigslist that say, great exposure, play for free, that kind of thing. And just, I mean, it's also whenever an orchestra goes on strike, there's a spate of publicity with people saying, but they're just having fun, why do we have to pay them? Not realizing, and also the, you know, the salaries seem extreme to outsiders, but when you think of especially what string instruments cost, I mean, it seems reasonable to me.
Well, it's also, if you think about the fact that I think what people, I was just saying to people in like in the case of the St. Louis Symphony, that, you know, to get into an orchestra like that, it, you know, it's a very small group of folks that are going to get into it.
Oh, yeah.
It's like that, and when you consider the fact that the base salary is, you know, $90,000, these are for people at the top of their game.
Yeah.
And, you know, you can be a third-rate attorney and start, you know, making more money than that. And so I think it's unfortunately, it's part of the value proposition, I think, you know, of how society values it. But I think also, the answer is not that, and I think this is where musicians have to be careful, my own view, is that I think we sometimes expect people to love it as much as we do. We expect people to value it as much as we do. And that's not the way the world works, realistically. And that's a painful truth, I think, that people sort of come to. And so that it comes back to that idea that you have to really be motivated to do this. I mean, you have to want to do this and not do anything else, I think. And that's, you know, in order to go into this field.
Yes. Or, well, in my case, in many ways I was. My family had a Fulbright to Vienna when I was a child, mm-hmm. where I first came in contact with classical music, and there was so much I loved about it. You mm-hmm. know, it was just a magical mm-hmm. time that was so, I'm from North Carolina, so this was very, very different. And we went across the ocean on a ship and everything. Mm-hmm. But then, as I was in high school, I started feeling trapped, like it wasn't my choice after all. Mm. So I think musicians come in 100 different variations, but those are two big ones. People who absolutely love it from childhood, and people who are as conflicted as I was.
That's interesting. That's a good point.
Because you have to start so early.
Yeah, right. And if it's the only thing you know when you've sort of been, you know, that's what you've always done.
Yeah.
It's, yeah. Makes sense. Yes, back here.
We have a question from online. Mm-hmm. Somebody's asking if being a freelancer taught you to be more adaptable in other situations beyond musical performance.
Absolutely. Because you have to, I mean, I would leave in the morning with, you know, several costume changes depending on what was going on and a couple of instruments, and then I was in school at Columbia, so I had my chemistry textbook, and you have to find places to hang out and how to figure out how to get places. you know, there was this famous corner at 96th and West End where everybody picked up everybody to go on gigs out of town. But you would have to arrange all of this stuff by yourself. So I think in terms of being a reporter, and I was a staff reporter for a couple of newspapers while still being a musician, you kind of MacGyver everything. And I think that's a real positive aspect of freelancing.
You gotta have good nerves too. I mean, because you would show up and, you know, play stuff you hadn't seen and with no rehearsal. And
that's what Enderall is for.
Yeah, I understand. I understand that. But nonetheless, it's, you know.
Well, yeah, I mean, traditionally a recording gig, like when I played on the soundtrack of Malcolm X, which was absolutely a phenomenal experience of my life. And everybody else left and they called me and the concertmaster back, who was Sanford Allen, the first black violinist, black member of the New York Philharmonic. Mm-hmm. And then they let him go. And as I was sitting there, they wrote out the cue. Mm-hmm. So I'm what you hear when Malcolm X dies. Mm-hmm. And I, you know, I hadn't seen it. And it was actually kind of difficult because it was very in the low register and very soft. Mm-hmm. So you do have to deal with that. They're writing it right there. Right. And sometimes it's kind of hard.
Yeah. Other questions or comments for Blair? Yes.
So you said oboe wasn't your first choice in instruments, so what would be if you could start over?
I wanted to play the flute or the trumpet, but they were all gone. So they had oboes and bassoons left. So it was me and a girl named Rye Young, and I forget who the person in between us was. We all ended up with oboes.
Yeah. Those pesky devil reeds. That's the problem.
At least I didn't become a poultry inseminator.
Right. Well, anything else you think we should know about Mozart in the jungle or, you know?
Well, I'm
it's going really for another season, or do you have multiple seasons? Do you know what the
No, you never know until
you don't know, yeah. Yep.
So the third season will drop, as they say, on a week from Saturday. And much of it was filmed in, there's some really interesting things, very interesting things in it. Some of it was filmed in Italy, as you saw. And then the Golden Globe nominations will be announced a few days after that. Mm-hmm. So maybe we'll get one. It won an Emmy for, Creative Emmy for sound mixing, which was really nice because it's, you know, it is what it is. And they've really upped their game. I'm very happy with it. Mm-hmm. People often ask me if, you know, they're expecting me to be angry with them and that something's wrong with the show. And I love it. They've been great to me. They've taken some characters and personalities directly from the book. They've made up some wonderful new ones, like the whole conductor scenario with Rodrigo and Malcolm McDowell is great. You know, Malcolm McDowell was the actor in Clockwork Orange.
Oh yeah, what a great actor.
And he's a lovely person too. They all are. And Bernadette Peters is kind of, sort of, reminds me of Deborah Borda. And they've all just done a great job and really thrown themselves into doing their best to learn the instruments. Like Saffron Burroughs, the tall actress who's the cellist, she studies with Carter Bray and the Philharmonic. And Ransom Wilson taught conducting to the two actors.
Okay.
And I played fourth horn in the orchestra for one session. And I learned to play all the notes by the end of the day.
Wow.
But we had to follow Malcolm and Gael, and they actually both did pretty well, I thought. I was impressed. But everyone worked hard. Everyone has a coach who's on set all the time. They take private lessons with them. And I think everybody's surprised that, you know, how difficult playing instruments really is. So we'll know after the Golden Globes probably, you know, if we win any, definitely, I would assume the fourth season is probably a foregone conclusion, but you just never know. And also it's their project, not mine now.
Right. Are you going to write another book?
Yes, it's on the way.
And what's the topic?
Well, it's what happens after the memoir when you have to change careers and your life is never going to be the same again. and other eccentricities of life, as you can imagine.
Is it a how-to book, sort of, how to
no,
make that transition?
No, it's just another memoir.
No?
Yeah. Well, sort of. I mean, yeah, it is a little bit. Because I did have to do some fairly strange jobs, but they're out there. And I often hear people my age end up complaining that, oh my God, what am I going to do? There's no work. There's always work out there. You can always do something and then just get along until you figure out the next thing that you really want to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
And also my father was a professor of black history in the 50s. And he had told me about a black Civil War hero that people have tried to write about, but it's very difficult because his dramatic arc doesn't really work out for movies. So I figured out a way to do it.
Oh.
So I'm signed with one of the Hollywood agencies, and they're trying to sell that now. And also a travel show that's sort of Bourdain-ish, but it's world music and dance. So trying to find somebody who's kind of a more of a pop culture-y music host who might be able to do that. So that's, I was working on a show, a comedy about sexually deviant ushers at the ballet, but it fell through. Well, I was one.
Real life intrudes again.
But yeah, I just couldn't be more thrilled about Mozart, and nobody else expressed interest but the Coppolas, and then, I mean, how lucky can you get?
Yeah, that's amazing.
Yeah, and it really has brought us into the limelight in a very positive way, I think. And it also has hired a lot of our famous colleagues. Like, you haven't lived till you've seen Manny Acts on the Dance Revolution Machine. And then Joshua Bell showed up at the shoot with his own bowling ball of all the nerdy things. And Long Lon was there, and he's, you know, I talk about being snarked at. A lot of people do snark at him, but he's a lovely person, and he was very enthusiastic about it. And then we had Alan Gilbert, too, and Plethido's in this year's. So I'm sure they'll get some more.
Yeah, it's fun.
I think Jimmy Galway kind of wanted to be in it.
Ah. Well, thank you for joining us for this, and
oh, thanks,
and I really
Fred.
Appreciate your candor and your just
the
no seriously it honestly it comes through in the book and in person, and you know, I just think it's lovely the way you have sort of laid this out.
Well, I love classical music and I love my tribe. Yeah. And I wanted to try to do something that would help.
Yeah.
So. Yeah.
Well, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having us. Thanks for coming.